Now you listen to me real good. I've told you once, I said it 1,000 times. You get out of those pagan, satanic, religious, Christian churches. Christians do not follow the commandments of the Bible. Christians do what they want to do. They make up their own laws, their own rules, and their own regulations. Come out of her, my people, and come out from among them. And it's real simple and easy to ascertain who are these people you need to come out from. Easy. Number one, if they keep Sunday, that's an automatic sign that you need to not have any fellowship with these commandment-breaking, wicked deceivers and seducers and bewitchers of the truth. Simple.
Everybody's all right? You know, I have a very serious concern for Israel, and the concern is hearing. You know, the Bible says that faith comes by hearing. And it's disturbing to me when you can't hear. It may not disturb you, but it disturbs me greatly. You following? Because if faith comes by hearing, and you can't hear, how can you increase in faith? Huh? And we're not talking about hearing sounds. Are y'all listening? We hear that quoted all the time, but we have very little comprehension to what it really means. Faith come by hearing? And what if you have something in front of you that prevents you from hearing? Can you have faith? Can you increase in faith? And we hear many things on a daily basis. But the word says that hearing comes by the word of Yah. Now you have to have faith in order to hear, because it's that faith that will cause you to hear, that will enable you to hear the word of Yah. But if you're having a difficult time hearing, then how can you increase in faith? How can you mature? How can you grow? How can you go from faith to faith? You know, last night, I know a lot of people, you know, as usual, think that Pastor Dowell is making a mountain out of a molehill. When I was talking to Brother Brad, I had to actually even get up from the mic. Come in here, holler, and scream at the saints here in the tabernacle just to make sure that I'm hearing right. So I could check my hearing. And they confirmed, no, you said it. Yep. And with everybody else, it's a laughing matter. But to me, it greatly disturbs me. You know, it ain't funny when you get rebuked. Is it? How does it make you feel when you get reproved? Openly. Because the day may come, we may be in a position or a place, and I'll say, Brother Brad, if you go do this, it may be a life or death situation, and he didn't hear me. Uh-oh. And this I thought you said stuff. Yeah, you thought. Say it again. I thought. Say it one more time. I thought. One more time. I thought. That's the problem. That's the problem. We don't ever hear preaching like this. They don't even call this preaching today. And yet we check the word, it says preach the word. Don't it say that? Be instant in season. Last night was an out of season experience. Then it says, reprove and rebuke. Now, how many people want to hang around for something like that? Then the admonishment says, and do it with all long-suffering. It's implying that the one that's doing the suffering is the one who's doing the preaching. You think you're suffering because you feel something. Your emotions get a little stirred up or something like that. You think you suffering. What about the one that's doing the preaching? Nobody ever thinks about the preacher. It's all about me. My feelings hurt. Let me go and check with my Pizzo and Chum and Pal and ask them, why does the preacher have a problem? Why he got to pick on me? Isn't that how we think? He that reproveth or rebuketh in the gates is hated. Not you that's feeling the ding in your spirit. By the time you get finished spitting in everybody's ear, something wrong with the preacher. Then it goes back to faith come by hearing. And here it comes by the word of Yah. And how can he hear without a preacher? Not how can he hear when my feelings are hurt and I got to go tell everybody why my feelings are hurt. And I become a preacher of emotion rather than discerning Yah's body. Over this time, from trumpets up till atonement, we should have been doing some serious inward reflection. When Brother Brad got corrected last night, you should have got corrected too. You should have been saying, help me, Yah. Have mercy on me. Wonder how many times I do stuff like that. It's very important that we hear the voice of the Spirit. Uh-oh. See, and then we look at me with that thousand-yard stare. And we wonder, well, what's wrong with him this morning? Ain't nothing wrong with me. I'm not the one that's troubling Israel. Israel's already in trouble. That don't disturb you that you can't hear? Because you can't hear, you can't perform. And it goes back to faith, comma, by hearing. Now think about that for a second. Now faith is the substance, of things hope for. See, that hope, that's when it's in your imaginations. It's the evidence of things not seen. Everything you see materialized in the natural came because it was something that was hoped for. Something that was in your thought, and it manifested and it came to pass. And that same faith has a language that says the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen are eternal. But what do you put most of your emphasis on? You put so much emphasis, unbalanced, on the temporal, the physical, that you diminish the value of the existence you're going to be spending the majority of time or ages in, which is eternity. Did I just say something wrong? I know I didn't. See, that's how we process thought, though. That's how we think. That's why Israel could never understand the prophets. They will focus on spiritual things. You'll focus on cardinal things, on natural things. Anybody ever know? Anybody knows what anguish of spirit is? Not, but you know what anguish of emotions is, don't you? It's hard to comprehend and understand the book. If we can't get this right, how in the world can we even begin to understand what the book is even speaking about? Everything we even dissect and discern, we do it from an alternate conscience based on the culture and environment and influences we had, and we think that we're thinking right. And then that word of revelation comes and causes us to think, wait a minute, I never saw that. You never saw it in the first place, but you discerned it, which means you saw it. See, it went right over your head. He's talking French now. There you go again. He's talking to some other Swahili and everything else. You'd be wondering, what in the world's going on in the mind? Because true sight is with the mind. Mind controls what you see. It does. But you're so used to seeing things from your perspective, you can't see the perspective. You don't believe me? If I sit up here and drew a big old six in the middle of the floor, from your angle, it's a nine. From my angle, it's a six. And I didn't ask you to see it from your angle. Just like Yah's not asking us to see his word through our personal experiences here on earth. It's up to us to understand him and to work towards that and put down the vain imaginations. I don't expect everybody to hear this, because you can't hear it unless it's been given unto you. You can't. There's no way. The natural man, he ain't thinking about the things of Yah, because they foolishness unto him. And that's, see, look at how much emphasis they put on preaching. Foolishness. He chose by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. And a natural man can't even receive the things of Yah because they're foolish unto him. Is that the reason why you can't hear? Still too natural. Still too carnal. See how this word is? Yes, sir. Word like a hammer, isn't it? Yes, sir. All of a sudden, it ain't funny no more, is it? No. Now, when the light of this word starts shining on you, right. You asked the saints last night. I came in there hollering in the tabernacle. You thought that they was the one that wasn't hearing. I had to ask them just to make sure that I was hearing what I was hearing. Boy, we got a formidable foe, don't we? If our gospel be hid, it's hid to them that are lost, in whom the mighty one or the God of this world have blinded what? And you think you're seeing with your eyes. The reason why you can't see is because your mind is blinded. See, we function out of a total different paradigm. The words is spiritual, is life, and we're natural and carnal. And we take issue with what spirit and life is. See how this book is? See it? And you can't hear unless somebody gets up and preach it, because you've read it 1,000 times. You ain't never got that out of it. Then he opened their understanding, mind. that they might understand the scriptures. And I think that we have the mind of Yah. But we'll find out based on your hearing. Noah preached 120 years and only 8 people heard him. No, man, no people heard him. No, they didn't either. Only 8 people heard him. Hmm? 500 people think that they heard the Messiah when he told them to go to Jerusalem. 500 people. And if you read it, you swear up and down that 500 people heard him. When I read it, only 120 heard him. Uh-oh. Well, Pastor Al said 500 people. Yeah, he talked to 500, but only 120 heard him. Y'all see how we do? See? See how strange it is to get you out of this Gentile, carnal, natural-minded mindset? You're going to preach to all these people all these years, 120 years, and the Bible says he's a preacher of righteousness too. And yet only 8 people can hear you? In that day, the Messiah was well known. The Bible said, and his fame went out. He was famous. His fame went abroad. And after the resurrection, getting ready to be received up in the glory, only 120 people heard him. They don't mess your mind up. He told him that he was going to resurrect after the third day. None of them believed except 2 women. See, you read it. You read the fairy tale Christian version of the appearance of Jesus. I don't read that one. Only one word throws me way, way off. It puts me right there in the room. And he upbraided them for their unbelief and hardness of heart. Shakes me to my very core every time I read it. Upbraided, they got scolded. Here's Christ done went down to hell, got the keys, freed people that were in there captive. He coming back expecting for his disciples to be waiting on him. He gets there and all he encounters is a bunch of damn unbelief and doubt. I can only imagine what he said to him. See, we just have these words written down in English form and stuff, and we really, truly think we know what that book says. Mind you, that's the same Yah that said, whoever sins against me, I will blot him out of my book. So it's hard for us to quote this fairy tale, Jesus. Because our minds have been so evilly affected against the real word, that's the reason why we don't take our life serious. And the book said in Mark 16 that he upbraided them for their unbelief and their hardness of heart. They didn't believe that he resurrected. And our whole message is all about the resurrection. Our hope is in the resurrection. This whole thing is about the resurrection. from the dead. He's been 3.5 years teaching them, preaching to them, things concerning the kingdom of Yah, and that's what he ended up producing. After spending all that time with them disciples. No wonder it says that he upbraided them. I wonder if he found the same whip that he whipped the money changers with in order to get their attention. See how it is when you read it with a right conscience? All of a sudden, that experience begins to jump off the pages. If you was the Mashiach, would you not be pissed off? After all this unbelief, you think you're just going to come up to him and have a hug fest? You mean to tell me I did all these miracle signs and wonders? I got impaled on that tree just so that you can't believe. You saw me on the Mount of Transfiguration. You did. Peter, James, John. Well, we sure do have a lot to do to get this wicked heart right, don't we?
Yes, sir.
To even to realize what tomorrow and atonement is all about. I fear that we have gone so far into this world in our minds that we have lost the fear of Yah. He did say, when he comes, here he is faced with the same problem again. Shall he find faith on this earth? And you know, the only thing that's going to keep our minds to the fire is a hollering and screaming, obnoxious, inappropriate, out of bounds, loudmouth, scolding preacher. Because you'll let it slip. You'll slip back off in the world. You'll slip back off in idolatry. You'll slip back off into yourself.
Help us.
Don't tell me we're any different than ancient people. All you got to do is read the history. We're no different than them. I promise you we're not. If somebody's not walking sober, if somebody's not walking circumspectly, boy, we are in trouble. Can we depend on you to keep our minds sober concerning the times? With all the foolishness we got going on and the frivolity we have going on? With all the crap we troubled about in our minds? Can we depend on you to keep Israel sober? See, what you're feeling right now is the way you should be feeling tomorrow.
Yes.
Should have been feeling like this the last 10 days. This message is serious. The rejoicing part is when he transforms us in a moment of a twinkle of an eye at the last trump, and then we know that we made it to the kingdom because he is the one who transformed us and not we ourselves. Is any of this making any sense? You got to check yourself. You truly got to check yourself. There's our family in Minnesota. Look at Evelyn. There's our family in Finland, blowing the trumpets. Now watch this, the next is depressing. Because here's us, a little straightway. And out of 35 people, 19 of them are no longer in that picture. Didn't he say that that day shall not come until there come a great falling away first? Didn't he say that? Did he not say the first shall be last and the last shall be first? Somebody got to fall away. Now you go run to their Facebook accounts. You go run to their social media accounts. They will swear up and down that they have not fell away from the faith. But in function, they have denied him. I said out of 35 people in that picture right there, on 19 are totally gone away from y'all. None of them, not a one of them have a witness or a testimony that would lead anybody to the fear of Yah. Starts getting a little bit bigger. And a little bit bigger, got majority of them fell away as well. All this during the Day of Atonement. We have in our mind, we assume we're going to make it from one feast to the next. Because our mind tells us, oh, I'm in the faith right now. That's, look at that. Look at Texas right there. Half of them are gone. Brother Case holding it down in the Netherlands. All these are Day of Atonement pictures. There's all the people that were sitting right there in that picture. Every one of them up here now. I bet after that storm they hear about it, they say, damn, we so glad we got out of there. Every time I see a storm, I say, it looks like y'all's trying to wash that foul place. Using the devil to wash it. They all here too. Should be happy to see you still in the faith. Still in the battle. Brother Freddie and them over in Germany. Of course, Brother Case over there too at another atonement. Brother Case is popping up everywhere. What? Atonement? I'll be there. There's the Kansas. And well over, let me see right here. A quarter, just a quarter, maybe just a few of them fell. They've been able to hold on. Done had many people come and go, come and go, come and go. I sure like that hairstyle, though. Is that real? Yeah, that's him. Sister LaShonda and them, they still holding it down out there in Colorado. And these are the majority of people who they travel great distances and at great expense to come to spend the feast with us. And they don't have the encouragement of the saints around them 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They don't get to come and attend Shabbat, get to hug your neck, worship with you. They hanging on. There's 2013. Half of them are gone. Picture sitting right in here. I keep telling folks the straightway is the front line. You understand that? In other words, the front line is where the majority of the people die. Because that's where the heat of the battle is. The heat of battle ain't back in garrison at the supply line. It ain't at the water depot. Uh-oh. Yeah, it ain't at the medic's clinic either. At the medic! Sobering, isn't it? Look at South Carolina. All of them are still there. But they had a picture that had over 20 of them in it. So people come and people go and none but the righteous remain. Plus, you can add Mama Gregory in there too. Amazing, huh? See them getting bigger? That's South Carolina again. 2014, there they are right there. There they are the next year, 14. And only these remain. Y'all get it? There they are. There they are. Amazing, isn't it? There's Canada, only two remains. See, you can almost bank on, I told you, there's usually a five-year mark. Usually. I didn't say that's the hallmark. Usually if you can make it five, you have a 75% chance of making it to 10. Boy, many of you, Satan almost had you to check out this year, didn't he? All over in emotion. I wonder what Satan can check you out on. A misunderstanding. Wonder how he can get you. Bitterness against one person. I wonder what wiles of the devil he can use. What can get you out? Almost, some of y'all almost got you too. This year he almost got you, and we only in the seventh month. We got the dead season we got to go through. Or maybe it was an offense. We're not ignorant of the devil's devices. Well, apparently somebody has been. There straightway again, you can knock half of them out of there. There's Georgia. Boy, they really thin now. They really thin now. How in the world can you, let me see, how did Christ put it? How can you say, are y'all listening? How many of y'all love the Father? Okay, now we're going to test that boast. How many of you can say that you love the Father who you cannot see? Got you, don't we? And then you got a brother. And you got a sister who you can't see. I got people coming to this feast, swapping down and love y'all, but they can't love their brother and sister enough to fellowship with them. You are a liar, and the truth is not even in you. See, somebody got to fit that scripture. They deceived themselves, sporting themselves with their own destruction. And they do all this while they feast with you. Y'all think I'm quoting the Talmud or something like that? Huh? I know I'm quoting. I know y'all read this book. I know you do. Now, we just got finished checking your spirit. So much for the love of the Father now, isn't it? So much for the love of the Father now, isn't it? Hypocrites! These are the same ones. The king going to walk in and said, friend! Friend! How did you get in here without a wedding garment? Blah, 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 blah. Yeah, with your hypocrisies, your lies, your deceivings, your cheatings, your deceptions, your excuses. Uh-oh. So much for love of the Father. So much for love of the Father. Getting bigger, isn't it? Last year, Day of Atonement. Let me do a scan to see how many is there. I'm looking for Judith. There she is. Now, Judith, this year, you turn around and look. Maybe that ain't Judith. Maybe that's Judith. Man, we got 98% of the people stuck around. That's pretty good. Or is it? See, a lot of people claim no to follow, don't they? And of course, that was my atonement garment 50 years ago. Y'all had already had me in practice. See it? Wearing my all white. Got praise in my hands. I tell you what, we got a lot. We got a whole lot we need to learn. You know, we need to start seeing the way y'all sees. And not the way that we see. Day of Atonement. Hebrews 60, 31, afflict, anon. Humbling, depressed, literally, abase self-gentleness. In other words, you're supposed to purposely whoop yourself. And I ain't say take no lashes and start doing the Catholic thing either. You should be feeling sorry for the condition of your mind. Amen. Bible says be afflicted and mourn. That's where your mind should be at. So you start thinking about all this blood that was shed for you. We already know this story about the scapegoat, the two goats. We know about Azazel. The one that was let go in the wilderness with your sins confessed on it. My sins. What a job the high priest had to do, huh? Had atone for himself first. Very serious. Very serious business. Hebrews 6:84 to Zoom. To abstain from food fast. Someone say, is it really a fast day? Again, what happens with us is we go out there and we hear, there are. As if there may be in this world so many different kinds of voices. And all of these voices have a meaning. And all of them seem like they're significant. Just because they have a voice. Dawid said in Psalms 35:11, false witnesses did rise up and laid to my charge things that I knew not. They rewarded me evil for good to the spoiling of my soul. But as for me, when they were sick, my clothing was sackcloth. And how did he humble his soul? With what? See, we're concrete people. Most of you, you can't humble your soul. One thing I learned about fasting long, long time ago. Sure does take that fire to you when that sugar's in you, though, don't it? That sugar's at high octane. You want to watch these children go from 100 miles an hour to zero? Watch the fast tomorrow. You ain't got to worry about them, boy. You ain't got to chase them at all. They'll be the most docile you ever seen them. And you too. Uh-oh. Should tell you something, huh? Most of you eat too much rather than fasting. Because when you eat, you're in full strength, full rebellion. Full discord. Oh, look at here. I mean, you're not afflicting yourself enough, but you sure are causing a lot of affliction. Don't fast and help you humble your soul.
Yes.
Takes all that energy out of you, don't it?
Yes.
You ain't got time for the fight then, do you? Uh-oh. Well, you know, it doesn't say in the law that we have to fast, but I can tell you what our people, how they understood it. They fast. To the humbly, I humble my soul with fasting and my repair turn to my own bosom. Bamikbar 29:7 says, and on the 10th day of the 7th month, you have a set apart gathering. You shall afflict your beings. You do no work. Listen, Israel, remember we are concrete people. Words given to us by our captives may change them in meaning. However, always remember the function of our ancient people. So when people start telling you all these things, well, I looked in this word right here, and this word says this, and this word says you don't have to afflict your soul this way. What you need to do is have your mind help you afflict your soul. So I'll go to someone who Yah said it was created after my own heart, Dawid, and I'll see how he humbled himself. Because I know, we all know he's an Israelite, right? And I say, you know what? That sounds good. I think he got it down. It's better to take his testimony and listen to these fools today, vainly puffed up in their mind. And when you see them, they so arrogant, you can tell they never fasted a day in their life. Is that the reason why we have so much discord amongst the brethren? So much strife is because you ain't never fasted a day in your life. Some of you think you fast and all you did was skip a meal and went hungry. You ain't dedicated nothing to y'all. You ain't never got your mind right to be able to afflict your soul because you're raising too much hell. We need an atonement. Then I get people with a contrary spirit. Why you have to always talk to us like this? Because you need to be talked to like this. That's the problem today. You ain't been talked to right. You ain't never preached right. I can quote to somebody where Isaiah said, cry aloud and spare not, and lift up your voice like a trumpet, and they'll still take issue with the crying aloud and spare not. And the offense is not man, the offense is just against Yah and his kingdom. What a shame. The whole purpose of crying aloud and spare not because somebody got to holler and scream loud enough than those thoughts that are in your head. It's hard penetrating those things that keep ministering to your mind. Even the demons in their mind be going, man, that's just tell them be quiet. Automatically, that's just be something to tell you, what the hell was that? That's what should be going on. King David said that he humbled his nephesh, meaning soul. The soul is the soul, the appetite, mind, desire, emotion, passion, inner thoughts of a man. Humbling himself, he's humbling the seats and appetites, the emotions, the activity of mind, the will, the character of man. I mean, you have to humble yourself, flick yourself, make yourself lowly and abased. How many of y'all heard me say this many, many moons ago? I said, you want to find out how spiritual you are? Get to a quiet place and be quiet for 5 minutes and see if you can still your mind that you have nothing but stillness and not one thought. Most of you can't make 10 seconds. By the time you had a minute, you're about to rip your hat out of your head. See, most of you love preoccupation. You love staying busy doing something, having noise going, or using music as a crutch. Yeah, you do. You like making all these distractions. Because all this junk going on up here, you're trying to drown out. Not dealing with the y'all's body. To tell you that there's something in the temple. In the very walls. Try it. See if you can make it 1 minute. 5 minutes is, man, that's really being generous. Just go 1 minute. You ain't going to make it 1 minute before you have to find yourself to cast something down, clear the hard drive, and start all over again. I know how we are today. See, we're functioning on that solid state drive mindset where we don't have to do any defragging. Now, you computer guys know what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
Willful placing yourself under the authority of another. You know that's what we're doing? We're purposely at least bringing to our conscience this time of the year that we are willfully, regardless of what everything else is going on and stuff. See, he already made sure that we can dedicate this time to him because he says it's a law that you don't work. I don't want no distractions. I want your mind totally on me, under my law, under my word, totally 100% under my submission. That's what Yah says. Watch and see how much you try to find something else to do. Uh-oh. Leviticus 16. Get my cloudy spotlights. All right, check this out. Listen to the book. And Aaron shall offer a bullock for the sin offering, which is for himself, and make an atonement for himself, and make an atonement for himself for and for his house. And he shall take the two goats and present them before Yahweh at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for Yahweh and the other lot for the escape goat. And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which Yahweh's lot fell and offer him in a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before Yahweh to make an atonement with him and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. I've seen so many people mess up that story over the years. It's just unbelievable. Yah shed his blood, took our place. And to the world, that's foolishness. They repudiate the fact that there's this thing called the Mighty One is going to come down and atone for you.
Right.
It's an insult to them. Because that's how vain that mind is. Tehillim 119:71, it was good for me that I was afflicted, that I might learn your laws. That gives you a good little bit of instruction in on it. Huh? Oh, it should be, probably would be a good idea to be in this law tomorrow, wouldn't it? Oh, hallelujah. So I told you, the reason why most people don't have time for the Bible because they don't have time to have their minds changed. I can tell you, I can look at people and tell and watch you and tell that you're not spending time with Yah. See, this is how we do. What we do is we have a subject And then we go look for verses to confirm what we already believe, and we call that studying. Yep, that's what I thought it meant. There it is. Yep, mm-hmm, sure enough. And we call that studying. No wonder y'all only let the priest hold the scrolls and they would preach to you. Probably the best thing in the world for us to get the Bibles out of your hands, because look at the mess you are with them in it. Even in the Catholic faith, the people got more fear of the priest. They don't even care around books. You care around books and this make you more rebellious. Cause you to sow more discord among the brother. There's no way that you could be filled with the Ruah with all this hell and all this inworn and fighting going on. Not amongst your brethren. You can't be. Brother Shane, get Proverbs 6:16. Impossible. Walk with me. Walk with me. Walk with me. Walk with me. While I'm on this Holy Ghost journey, I want you, Jesus, to walk with me. Do you really? Brother James asked me the other day, he says, where in the world you get all them songs? I said, brother, they just in there. I said, I couldn't even, if you tell me to sing what I sung 2-3 Sabbaths ago or whatever last week, I couldn't do it, brother. They just, you just got to put some money in the jukebox. Proverbs 6:16.
These six things doth Yahweh hate.
Y'all hear that? How many times you read this? How many times have you read this? If you read this at least 5 times, raise your hand. All right, we're going to find out. Because remember, we started this thing, faith come by hearing, right? Huh? Isn't that right? And hearing, substance, performance. That's what you're basically going to see if you really truly heard. That we know that the people heard in Noah's day because 8 of them heard. Isn't that right? We know 120 heard them. The Messiah, right? Even though 5 of them, 500 of them, so-called, heard. Read.
Yeah. 7 are an abomination unto him.
Now, how many say they read this at least 5 times? Oh, now the hands are dropping now. Hey, y'all, saints, check it out. It's straightway. Every time we go a little bit farther, hands drop. It's straightway. Read on.
A proud look.
Oh. You know some of y'all, not only you have a proud look, you have a proudful walk. Uh-oh. You ever been in conflict with someone? You ever see what happens to your spirit? Read on.
A lying tongue.
What kind of tongue?
A lying
Some
tongue.
Of you just lied with immunity. And the reason why you lie, because you know ain't nobody going to come and fact check you behind nobody else. See, the majority of people you lie on, you know that them people are not going to go to the people you talking about and ask if you're telling the truth. You know why? Because you wouldn't do it. So you just believe everything. Let me see. Law says one witness shall not rise up against another. But you don't care. That's your friend. And the commandment says, thou shalt not bear what? Even if it's one witness, it's a false witness. Even if that witness is telling the truth, it's a false witness until it's examined. How many people say they've read this before? Now ask yourself how you really truly read it. Now the hands go back down again. See how we can tell that you really truly not comprehend, understand? Because your life will be a reflection of the spirit, which Yah's word is spirit. And life of what's really truly governing you. Want to be like Jesus, right?
Yes.
We got to have his word in you.
Right.
I will hide thy word in my heart that I might not what?
Sin.
Now first let's get this right. All sin is against Yah. But you don't care because you're opposing your brother or your sister. And you wipe it out of your mind that you're not sinning against Yah. So you give yourself a pass. At least David will say, against thee and thee only have I done this. That's why we don't have the fear of Yah in our hearts no more. We love deflecting and reflecting. I thought we said we read this. Lying tongue, come on.
And hands that shed innocent blood.
Well, we know that we're not running around shedding innocent blood physically, right?
Right.
Yeah, but how much hate we had to deal with.
Right.
In our hearts. Because you know you're not going to, you think that nobody can see your hate. You know the reason why you think that nobody can't see your hate? Because you can't see hate. I tell you, you function the way you think. You are the epitome of all righteousness. And you are the sum of all wisdom. And you are so spiritual that nobody can see beyond what you can see. But let me see, he that is spiritual judges all things, but yet he himself is judged by. Then you find his word being preached to you, and then the very secrets of your heart are being judged. So much for not being seen. His word is like a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Isn't that something? Notice the light bulb goes off when the word is really truly preached, when the real word is preached. Ain't no hiding from him then. I trip out. They got revival tents all up and down this pagan place. I'm like, what the hell are you trying to resuscitate? What are you trying to revive? Well, something's dead. It's dead. Can you imagine that revival? And only you, your wife, and a dog show up, and you're trying to sit up here and encourage yourself. And you got to do this for 7 days in a row. Go into some of these revival tents and see how many people show up. These folks ain't looking for no revival. Read on.
A heart that deviseth wicked imaginations.
I'm going to get you. I'm going to get them. You watch and see. I'm going to think evil. Now, we ain't going to say it. We just going to do it. Because the book does teach us to cast down. Don't it? So we let these flood of thoughts just go through us and not do anything about them. A heart that devises wicked imaginations. You ain't thinking on the thing which is good. The only thing you can think about is what somebody perceived done to me. If you see a brother overtaken in a fault, you're spiritual, ain't you? Instead of figuring out a way trying to get them, how about you consider one as yourself?
Come on.
Oh, how many said they read this? Now, how many live in it? Uh-oh. They that preach the gospel must live. Well, I'm not a preacher. You are all ministers. You ain't getting by me. Want to hear that mess? You are a living testimony. A walking tabernacle. What house are you building here? I go pray. I remember years ago, I go places and preach like this to the Baptist, man. And boy, when it's all said and done, man, everybody's just enthralled, just beside themselves. All that word, they ain't going to worry about it. It was only there just for that moment and that time. As soon as you get out that door, life hits you again, you're going to carry on in your way. Isn't that true? How many of y'all went with me when we went up to Howard's church up here? You remember where that reflexology guy, Howard? Y'all were there? Raise your hands real high. That's a long, long time ago, boy. Woo, and Elder Doug and him got his hands up. Y'all remember I was preaching? Boy, I was getting it. And all of a sudden, I stopped in the middle of preaching. I said, hey, there's somebody back there that's got hepatitis C. God said, if you come up here right now, he will heal you. And I looked directly at him, too. I looked directly smack dab at him when I said it. Went back to preaching. Said it again. You know that person never did come up? Guess who did come up in the line? His mama. Hey, do you know who that was? I sure do. Second row from the back over on the left. That's my son. Can you come pray for him? Ma'am? No! He has missed his day of visitation. I don't know him. I don't even thinking about him. I'm busy preaching the word. But when Yah intervenes like that, oh, Yah ain't intervening, stuff like that. Wonder how many times Yah did speak through the mouths of the prophets and different men of Yah. You know what I mean? Thus saith Yahweh, Elohim of Israel. Oh, I know, Pastor Dow, that's dispensationalism. We got you all figured out. Pragmatism. It happens right in front of us. We find ourselves right in the midst of it. And that woman literally was begging me. Even as the service was over with, leaving out, she says, if I tell you where we live, can you please come? Ma'am, I told you. No. You know, there's a day coming that the master is going to rise up and shut to the door. Noah built an ark with a big old door. And with all the wisdom that he had to build that ark, he did not have enough intelligence given to him that he could shut the door. Y'all said, no, this is what I am going to do. Imagine if I'm up there preaching and I refused to say his word at that time. So I'm not going to be the one that when it's all said and done and we're just me and Yah, that he going to be dealing with me. Didn't I tell you to say this? You ain't the one performing the miracle. I'm the one performing the miracle. Just do what I tell you. I'm not going to have that. You never know when that's going to be spoken. If it applies to you, you better hope you're ready. Because that woman begged me. And I told her no once. I said it 1,000 times. No, no, no. And I'm going to spell it for you. N-O-W-T. No. Now what do you do from there? You get mad at the preacher for obeying Yah, right? I'm supposed to go past Yah's will just in order to accommodate you, waste my time and yours, knowing that Yah's not going to heal him after that. The day you hear his voice, well, that's your voice. The day you hear his voice. And what happens? We got hardened hearts. Sorry, folk. There, y'all does have men on this earth that's serving him. I didn't say a man. I said men. He does have them. It's all amazing. How many of y'all was there? Am I telling the truth about this story? It's been so long ago. How many years has it been? Anybody know? At least 11? Man, it's been a long time. Can you imagine that? One lady I asked, you want to receive the Holy Ghost? Nope, don't want to receive the Holy Spirit. Turned around and died the next week, fell over on a lawnmower, riding lawnmower. That was at Howell's church. She came up in line, wanted prayer for something. I said, you want to receive the Holy Spirit? No, 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 not right now. And died the next week on a lawnmower. Can you imagine riding a lawnmower? Pow! I bet Howard them thought, man, I ain't never having him ever come back here again. That's too much going on. It's amazing. Every time Yah brings judgment to a house and stuff, people equate it as demons. That's what happened to Israel. They got sick and tired of Yah judging. We're going to go over and serve Dagon. Dagon won't treat us like that. We're going to serve all these other mighty ones. They turn around. They ain't trying to oppress our lives and make us feel bad. Can you imagine? Moses said, you bunch of damn rebels! Oh, Israel. Read.
Feet that be swift in running to mischief.
What?
Feet that be swift in running to mischief.
Let's use modern day device. Telephone. Dial pads. Yeah, computer, Facebook, huh? Swift in running to mischief. Ain't got nothing good, no testimony to say, nothing good to say about what y'all's. There was old holiness people that used to say that if you ain't got nothing good to say about nobody, don't say nothing at all. I had somebody scold me after preaching one day, Elder Donnie. They said, you know, you preaching, act like that you so holy and righteous. I said, boy, what a fool you are. I said, I preach like that because I already know where he done bought me from. I was more of a bootlicker and a jackleg than you ever have been. That's the reason why I preach the way I preach. Because as hard as I was on myself and stuff, I'm going to be that way towards you. Now what you got to say? When you don't give nobody, when you don't give yourself a pass, then nobody gets a pass. When you give yourself a pass, you give everybody passes. Uh-oh. Y'all all right? You still in love with Yah? You read his passage before? Read.
A false witness.
A what kind of witness?
False.
A false witness that do what?
Speaketh lies.
You know there's people that purposely can't stories to make your mind go a certain way. And they also withhold certain information to make sure your mind go a certain way. Uh-oh. That ain't you. That's that person next to you. Read.
And he that soweth discord among brethren.
Let me see. Y'all said that these are six things that I hate. Seven are and are. Are what? It is so detestable that he can't even stand it. And yet, this has become the normal function in an American's life. And we don't think we have anything we need to atone for. Some of us have been nothing but drinking up this kind of attitude and spirit all year long. And you don't think we got nothing to atone for? Nothing? Are you serious? Is his goodness that even brought us this far? And that is the truth. See, what we need to do, we need to get to the place where we're starting to thank y'all for words and messages like this. And the reason why we do it is because he's so good, he didn't leave us in the condition that we're in. He gave us an option to hear and obey. As well as you can choose to disobey. But when he told Yahshua, choose you this day, who you going to serve? He even gave you the choice you should make. That's what we do every year around these time of reflections. These moeds. These rehearsals. My question to all Israel is this. Do you really follow his authority? Raikah 23, 26, and Yahweh spake to Moshe, saying, on the 10th day of the 7th month, the day of atonement, it shall be a set-apart gathering for you, and you shall afflict your beings, and you shall bring an offering made by fire to Yahweh. And you do no work. Why? Anybody forgot? He don't know. He don't want you doing work because he don't want your mind preoccupied at all on this day with anything else but afflicting your soul. Doing some serious reflection. Looking deep inside. No distractions. You don't work on the same day, for it is a day of atonement to make atonement for you before Yahweh your Elohim. For any being who is not afflicted on that same day, he shall be cut off from his people. So I put up all those pictures because how many people come to these feasts and they make light of them? They think because they with us in body, Israel, that Yah's not going. He already told y'all. First that which is natural, then that which is spiritual. He used to just flat out kill folks physically. Now people are dying spiritual deaths, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. And you go and look at the reflection of these people's lives, you can see they're dead in their trespasses and dead in their sins. How blind are you? They sport when they feast with you. Feasting on their own destructions. That's what they're doing. You promise, swearing down, that they're just like you, one of you. They're in with Israel. And they did not take the feast serious. It was everybody else that had the problem. Everybody else, wasn't me. And now they're gone. And now they're cut off from among who? What does it say right there? The people. Cut off from who? See, when you're cut off from Yah's people, you're cut off from Israel. You ain't no island to yourself. He said he would be like a little sanctuary to you. He didn't say you wasn't going to be no sanctuary by yourself. Uh-oh. That's what the book says. Sorry, you leave Yah's people, you left Yah. In Moses' day, you wanted to leave Israel. Moses just thrust you through with a sword. You're an Israelite, you want to go lay with a foreigner? Oh, we'll wait till you get in the boudoir, and then we'll take a spear and run you both through. Uh-oh. That's barbaric, huh? No more barbaric than what you are today, parading around as an Israelite. Destroying the souls of many with your deceivings. Playing an agent for the Satan himself. Deceiving the hearts of the simple and the minds of the simple. Y'all going to get you. They've been saying for years, he going to get you, Pastor Dow. I'm still, he already got me, but I'm still waiting for him to get me. How can y'all get you who he's already got? See what it is. We've been in this all this time, and because much is given, much is what? Required, but all I want to do is just ease on into the blessing. Uh-oh. For any being who is not afflicted on that same day shall be cut off from his. So I keep telling you, people got all screwed up in their head. You ain't going to never see any of these people saying that they don't love Yah. In their mind, they do. Cut off from. I suppose that when we read the book, this is what Yah's doing. He got Peter over here on the day of Pentecost preaching. 3,000 souls was added. You had a case of the ass, but you decided you're going to go over here and Yah's going to speak to you by yourself, but he's going to ignore the 3,000 souls over here. See, that's the sentiments we got today. You go serve Yah your way, I'm going to serve him my way. I ain't got no way. I'm in the way. And if Yah sent you to hear me, he knew the way. You ain't gonna believe how many people, how many times y'all heard testimony of people saying, I prayed and said, Yah, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. Show me a preacher. Next thing you know, out of the blue, out of nowhere, up pops Pastor Dow. He did all that so that one or two things can be happening. Either you can come in or you can be broken and taken away. Uh-oh. Because I didn't go to none of them. Uh-oh. There's people that root up their whole livelihoods to move here just so they can murmur against Moses with the Cushite woman.
Oh, wow. Bring it up,
Pastor. What did Yah say to them? You three come up to the door of the tabernacle. Now you two come on up here. You mean tell me you wasn't afraid to speak against my servant? Wow. Same thing going on today. You mean tell me you prayed, asked Yah to lead you and guide you to a preacher. You get here and then you become a judge of the very preacher. You are a fool to the highest degree. You place yourself. Let's put ourselves over in the kingdom when David was king. I don't care what David was doing. You better not cross your lips. He killed you then. Amazing, isn't it? See, what they do now is they judge something that's sin that's not sin. And since in their book is sin, guess what? Now they're Yah's judging. They're his battle axe. And you find out I took your battle axe too and then used both of mine on this hand and yours on this hand and beat the hell out of you. Boy, this word is just so good. Good word. Good word, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
And any being who does any work, you think it's putting any emphasis on work?
Yes, sir.
I mean, it keeps saying it repetitively almost every single verse. On that same day, that being shall be destroyed from the midst of what? And you do no work. It's every verse. I mean, if he says something more than once in one small passage, you think he mean business? You do no work. A law forever throughout your generations and all your dwellings. It is a Sabbath of rest to you, and you shall afflict your beings on the ninth day of the month at eve, from evening to evening, observe your Shabbat. Leviticus 16:29, this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, you shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you. For on that day, Leviticus 16:30, and on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be clean from all your sins before Yahweh. Now, I hope y'all got that, right? It's the priest that's making sure you're clean. You present yourselves. They're going to be the ones to determine if you're clean or not. Now, since Yahshua is our priest, he's going to be the one to make the determining factor if you are clean or not. You just ain't going to clean yourself because you say a few words. You know how we're going to know if you're clean or not? If you make it to the next one. Uh-oh. And it shall be a Sabbath of rest unto you, and you shall afflict your souls by a statute forever. And the priest, whom he shall anoint, and whom he shall consecrate to minister in the priest's office in his father's stead, shall make the atonement and shall put on the linen clothes, even the holy garments. And he shall make an atonement for all the holy sanctuary. And he shall make an atonement for the tabernacle of the congregation and for the altar. And he shall make an atonement for the priest and for all the people of the congregation. And this shall be an everlasting statute unto you to make an atonement for you and the children of Israel for all their sins once a year. I thought y'all would have said hallelujah and draw us and clap to everything, something like that. And the reason is because for all your sins? You mean to tell me all this damn food you've been cutting all year long? All this time you put away Yah's law out of your mind and stuff, you get to bring a reflection on it. He gives you an opportunity to repent, to cleanse you, to wash you by the blood, to make sure that you can stay into his kingdom and stuff. And the best thing he can get is a hallelujah. And not even remember last year. He said to David, I put thy sins away from thee. Don't do like a lot of people done. Take it for granted and think that he done cleanse you from year to year. To think that you can go another year and just cut the same food you did last year. Keep mocking him. And see what happens. There's a lot of people that have mocked him in their ignorance. And mocked him and putting him out of their minds, thinking that they are not the ones that needed clean. It was everybody else that needed cleansing. Y'all see how serious this thing is? Day of Atonement. And he did as Yahweh commanded Moses. Acts 27:9. Now when much time was spent, and when the sailing was now dangerous, because the fast, you look behind that, that's the Day of the Atonement, was now already past, Paul admonished them. Exodus 32:30, and it came to pass on the morrow that Moses said unto the people, you have sinned a great sin, and now I will go up unto Yahweh preadventure and shall make an atonement for your sin. This is when they went and built a golden calf. Moses was up receiving the commandments, the law. They had a bunch of revelings going on and they built him a calf. See, today we don't build calves physically with our hand. We build them right here. We build idols in our minds. And you watch who you serve by your attitude. We watch you walk. We watch you talk. We watch how you behave. And we can tell who you're serving. Uh-oh. And Moses returned unto Yahweh and said, oh, this people have sinned a great sin, and I've made them gods of gold. Yet now, if you will forgive their sin. Remember, I talked about this hyphen some time ago. Moses just didn't sash you up in front of y'all and said, just blot me out of your book. No, he was saying this very carefully. You talking to the one that quickens and makes it alive. You talking to the creator, the one who can make something out of nothing. Had somebody years ago and said, you know what? Y'all are so mighty that he can just wipe this whole thing off and hit the reset button and start all over again. I said, you're about the dumbest person I ever met in my whole life. So you mean tell me he's going to break his word just so he can accommodate that wicked thought in your mind? He set this thing in order for all these many years to get a people. So when he gets sick and tired of his people, he can just, oh, you know what? I'll just destroy this earth and make another one right now. If he did that, he wouldn't be a Yah of his word, would he? He'd be just like you, a hypocrite that always go back on it. Wouldn't he? And he's not a man that he should lie. Neither the son of man, he should repent. I be wondering where these minds come from. I mean, the minds, really. You can tell, be not conformed to this world. And that's the problem. We still think like this world. But be transformed, how? By the renewing of your mind so that you can prove. How can you prove if you ain't got nothing in your mind to prove? Nothing but vain thoughts and vain imagination. Isn't it amazing how much time, effort, and energy we spend on vainness? And we give so much power to it. When you mad, boy, you give all your energy to it. Even that seething anger that causes your blood pressure to go up, your face to get flushed, and you just start stomping and putting many potholes in the grounds and everything else. It's so sad how you're so easily used by the devil. Do you wonder why come y'all can't use you? Double-minded person, unstable in all their ways. He can't trust you. Can't trust from one minute to the next. Don't ever know your fair weather Israelites. If the weather's good outside, you good. Starts raining, oh, it's over with. No consistency at all. Pissed in this season and out of season. That's what the book says. And if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of that book which you have written. And Yahweh said unto Moses, whosoever have sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. You hear that? John 1:29. The next day John seeth Jesus coming to him and said, behold, the Lamb of Yahweh take away the sin of the world. Psalms 103, verse 10, he have not dealt with us after our what? Nor rewarded us according to our what? I think our problem today is that we've gotten by with so much that we're kind of like a child who their parent keep telling them, don't do that, and nothing ever comes behind it. See, I didn't grow up like that. Dad, mom, dad said, don't do that. They ain't mean it. At first, I didn't believe they meant it until they tossed some fire to me. So when they said, don't do that, Guess what? Don't do it. I believed it. I was a believer. Did you hear me? I was a believer. Because I knew when they said don't do it, and I did it, they found out. It wasn't going to be no, well, let me tell you my side of the story. There is no side. Except this side. I can't remember them telling me not to do something two or three times. It just don't register. Oh, I follow the same sentiment with my two. Even still today, they see me, they flinching. Not that I'm going to hit them, but they got a good, healthy respect. Because they never know when I may black out and lose my mind. Oh, never mind. Never mind. I'm so glad he hadn't rewarded us according to our iniquities. Not according to what we deserve. For as the heavens is high above the earth, so is his mercy towards them that do what? Look how much mercy he got for them that fear him. Heavens are pretty high. That lets me know how merciful he is, because I need all, I'll tell you what, me, I need all the mercy I can get. I'll take a good healthy supply of it. And I'll keep me some in reserve. I need mercy. Hallelujah. As far as the east to the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from us. Beautiful thing though, isn't it? Have your sins gone, isn't it? Now people had asked me why come sometime I be spelling Elohim this way. It's because if you pay attention to sentence and structure, all vowels in the languages of the world are interchangeable. Did y'all hear me? That's a law. All vowels are interchangeable. So a lot of times you see me spell it like this. Sometimes like this. All I'm doing is changing the E to an A and the O to a Y and the I to a U. See, Elohim or Elohim, which is closer to the Aramaic. This is closer to Ashkenazi. So if you want to keep saying Elohim, I passed out and not going to have a falling out over you. Are y'all all right?
Yes, sir.
Good history lesson, wasn't it?
Yes,
sir. Or at least grammar, or whatever you want to call it, my broken English and Hebrew lesson. Some have asked how did I come up with the spelling with Elohim. There it is. Holiness as the way of life. You know that's what Yahweh was called us to? Holiness. It says follow peace with all men. And holiness, without which no man shall see Yah. Do you understand that? You follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see Yah. Leviticus 11:45, for I am Yahweh that bringeth you up out of the land of Mizraim to be your Yah. You shall therefore be what? Holy means set apart, for I am holy, set apart. It reiterates it again in Deuteronomy 7:6, for thou art what kind of people?
Holy.
That's what he says about you. That's what you are. Unto who? Yahweh Elohim. Yahweh Elohim have chosen thee to be a special people unto who? In other words, you don't belong to yourself. You have been chosen. Out of all the families and all the nations of the earth, you have been chosen. Well, who me? I don't look like I've been chosen. Then how you think you got here? Even when you came, you reluctantly came. You don't remember how you first came around me? You reluctantly came. You wasn't kicking your heels up. You don't know what that force was that was bringing you around. Amazing, isn't it? Come to find out the best decision you ever made in your life. Yeah, amazing. Oh, yeah, I may be the preacher, but I full well know who's doing the calling.
All right.
Oh, yeah, I do.
All right.
Yep, all I am is a shepherd with a staff, and I need to start using it more.
Hallelujah.
But you are the sheep of his pasture, and what people have done is fleeced you and made you a sheep of their pasture.
Oh, boy.
Mm-hmm. Amazing, isn't it? Above all people, that's what he says. You are peculiar people, special people, unto himself above all people on the face of planet Earth. For thou art set apart people unto Yahweh Elohim, and Yahweh have chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself. Above what? All nations on earth, man. He got a high opinion of y'all. Deuteronomy 14:21. You should not eat anything. Now, this is funny. Not in a funny way like hee hee ha 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 ha. But watch this. Watch this. That's the reason why when you're an Israelite, man, you better come on over. You been circumcised, you better come on over. Don't be playing this little. Today I'm a Gentile.
I'm Israel.
Today I'm a Gentile.
I'm Israel.
I had people who used to come to assembly here. Then when they get away from us, they go to the beaches, put two pieces of bikinis on and shake their nasty ass.
Bring it on.
And I'm the least of your trouble. There's somebody who has eyes that are greater than the eyes of man. Check this out. You should not eat of anything that dieth of itself. You hear that?
Yes,
something die of itself, don't you eat it. You shall give it unto the stranger. You don't eat it, but you can give it to the stranger. He say, bless you. That is in thy gates. That means the people among you. That he may eat of it, or you may sell it unto an alien. We can give it to Mitch Evans. Or Rick. We have a cow that dies. He don't know if it died to itself. They think it's a blessing. We'll quarter for him and give it to him. He said, oh, bless you. See, your problem is you think that, okay, I think I better do this way because that's Yah's law on me, and you want to impose Yah's law on these wicked folks. He has a high standard for you. For the heathen, we give it to them. Maybe they'll give us a blessing. If we got a cow to die, butcher that book and cord it up and give it to him, man. He may give us 20 rolls of hay. May even become a security guard, unpaid for us. Without set apart people under Yahweh Elohim, thou shalt not see thy kid in his mother's milk. I mean, you don't sit there and boil milk and prepare a lamb in its own mother's milk. Why all that? That don't make no sense to me. I like it based like that. But isn't that the mind of an American, though? You got Yah all figured out. Double ring 26:16. Today, Yahweh Elohim is commanding you to do these laws and write rulings. And you shall guard and do them with all your heart and with all your being. And you have today caused Yahweh to proclaim to be your Elohim. Have you? Have you claimed him? Have you proclaimed him to be your mighty one? And to walk in his ways and guard his laws and his commandments and his right rulings and to obey his voice. And Yahweh has caused you to proclaim today to be his people, a treasured possession, as he has spoken to you, and to guard all his commands, so as to set you high above all nations, which he has made for a praise, for a name, and for esteem. And for you to be a set-apart people to Yahweh, your Elohim, as he has spoken. Holiness is a laid claim to the entirety of a person's life. You should be so different than the people of this earth that people can see it in dress, they can see it in character, they can see it in attitude, they can see it in everything about you. Your speech, your conversation, the whole thing. Psalm 23:3. Who shall ascend unto the hill of Yahweh, or who shall stand in his holy place? He that have clean hands and a pure heart, who have not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Holiness separates us from the common and profane people of this land. You are simply better than all the peoples of this earth, Israel, because Yahweh said so. So act like it. Hallelujah. Last year, Tabernacles. Glory to the King. Well, we hope that these sayings won't slip, that they will sink deep down in your hearts. Hallelujah. And that you always keep his fear before your eyes. Hallelujah. Tomorrow evening, sunset, is when Day of Atonement. We'll be here in the tabernacle at 11 a.m. 11 a.m., the world's moon day. Just so I don't confuse anybody, Monday. All right. Just so nobody get confused. Yeah, out of all these years, first day, second day, third day, fourth day, what, we're going to be, what? Oh, never mind. Never mind. Y'all doing all right?
Yes, sir.
Let us stand. We're going to try to broadcast Atonement on the Pastor Dow's YouTube channel. We'll see if we're ready. If we're not there within 5 or 10 minutes after the signal comes on, then just go ahead and divert back to our signal over here on our own server at online-church.org or straightway live, straightwaytruth.com/live. Yahweh, you're wonderful. You're a blessing. And we thank you for everything you've done. You still, after all this time, have made us mindful of your order and your truth. We're grateful and thankful in this generation that you have called us and chose us to be a peculiar people. We only hope, Father, that we can put a smile upon your face, that you can see the testimony of our hearts and how serious that we are. We're here because we love you, and you know it. Nobody can deceive you. You know them that are yours. We thank you for this time bringing us to another holy feast of yours, called appointed time. We thank you for inviting us year after year after year, counting us worthy to even be here. For that, we're grateful. Bless all the Israelites throughout the land as they prepare their hearts and their minds. In the magnificent name of Yahshua. Shabbat Shalom. King coming.
Uh-oh, look at him looking.